In this video, we'll be taking a look at one of Eevee's superpowers, which is lighting our nebula using lots and lots of lights, creating a sort of living and breathing nebulascape.
Actually, that is precisely what Cycles hates most when it comes to volumetric rendering, the multiple light situation. The more omni-lights there are, the worse it tends to get. Here you can see it choking, trying to clear up multiple lights scattered in the noise folds. Actually, that's why we have resorted to pretty much just one single light throughout the Cycles portion of the course. With Eevee though, it eats this challenge for breakfast. So in the next 15 minutes, we'll have a look at how to exploit this unfair advantage of real-time rasterization to create breathtaking adventures of color and space in the multi-lightverse. After opening the file with the project, the first thing to do is jump into rendered mode. This is an Eevee chapter, so no surprises. As for the render engine choice there. As a quick reminder, we've covered the render settings essentials, mostly the tweaks found inside the volumetrics tab in the previous video, as for how to make Eevee look great, so feel free to check that out if needed. Alright, so let's start by creating a simple camera animation to fly around our nebula cube. Even though the viewport seems to be pretty responsive with the current render settings, for doing the animation work of any kind, we can squeeze some performance juice by dropping the tile size from 2 to 4 pixels, and that should make it run as buttery smooth as needed in most cases. For previewing our animation, we'll need a timeline visible, so I'll just expand a new window, which we can set to be our timeline, of course. Let's make it approximately a 5-second animation, so 120 frames in total, given it's 24 frames per second, which is set in the output settings, and also some settings like resolution, which I think can be limited to 1920 by 816, giving it a nice wide aspect ratio. What we can do next is create a new empty object from within the Shift A menu, clamping its size right away for purely aesthetic reasons. Basically, this will be the camera underscore aim object, or the camera pivot, which will hopefully make sense as we set it up here. Now I'll select our camera, hold shift and click the empty to add it to the selection and make it the active selection. Then we can go control P to parent the camera to this object. Now whatever transformation is happening with this camera aim helper object will make the camera move as well. For example, we can go R for rotation, then constrain the rotation to a particular axis by pressing X, Y, or like in this example, pressing Z, so that we can orbit the nebula around the Z axis, that sort of stuff. To record the keyframes for animation, I'll first right-click and then choose Insert Keyframe, which will give us a list asking us exactly what sort of property we want to keyframe. So for example, rotation, if that's what we actually want to record into a keyframe anyway. Anyways, after inserting the keyframe, we should see it appeared over here on the first frame of the timeline. Then what I'll do is scrub to the last frame, which is frame 120. Double tap R to activate the free or trackball rotation mode and give it a nice spin. And once again, right click to record a new keyframe at this frame. After doing that, we should be able to preview the camera animation by scrubbing the timeline or hitting play, which by default is assigned to the spacebar, I believe. Even such simple camera moves like that can go a long way in creating a sense of the third dimension, as the shifting perspective and parallax just makes everything 50 times more appealing. When we place down our keyframes, by default, Blender puts down some curvature to the interpolation, so it'll slow down and speed up, which we don't really want in this case. So I think we can get rid of that by selecting all of the keyframes and then pressing T and selecting linear. So it's a nice, consistent, well, linear movement. Yeah, I think looking at that playback, the motion's looking great now. Even though we'll start adding lights in just a moment, it could be worth rendering a preview. So for a quick preview, FFmpeg should work fine. I usually set the encoding to MPEG 4 as it's widely accepted by social networks and the like. The quality can be high if we like. The MP4 should go somewhere so we can define the output. At this point, we can just render it out. Hopefully it shouldn't take long, probably just a few seconds per frame, which actually hardly allows me time to even get the kettle on. Getting a fast render here though is obviously what we really ordered, so far from a crime when it comes to rendering, though I wouldn't say no to an opportunity for a beverage either, to be fair. In any case, I'm really happy with the basic camera move, just a little simple but effective swoosh through the clouds. All right, I think it's time to add some lights to it. As we've said before, one of the superpowers of Eevee is being able to handle a very, very large number of lights, even though a singular lamp can also produce beautiful shadows. First, I'll grab this point light and make it slightly weaker to clear some space for the rest of the setup, so to speak, and then I'll go ahead and start populating our scene with lights, mainly following the routine of duplicating the lights by using Shift D to duplicate and then move them with the G key, mostly with the goal of creating points of interest here and there. We can go wild with the colors of the lamps too, playing with the cold versus warm contrast theme, just to make it look as evocative as possible. Sometimes if you can't quite tell where the lamp is, it's worth turning on the UI overlays. While keeping the axes and the floor visibility off, that'll clean things up for us, but also allow us to keep track of the lamps. I'll keep duplicating the lights to keep the whole illuminating process going, not too dissimilar from painting with light, as it were. This process is essentially freestyle, so it is completely fine if you get a different looking result in the end. For example, I've chosen to go blood red with some lights, and this is an aesthetics choice, of course. The goal of this section should really be just setting your creativity free, and that's why we've been more forgiving with the volumetric settings, to give us this kind of fluidity. Eevee should definitely be real-time enough to support such a free-flowing sort of creativity. There's a very useful setting called custom distance, which is how we can control the spill or the radius of any light. So as you can see, I'm using it liberally in this example to fine-tune the look of our light splotches. Like here, we make this one pretty contained, like a little star submerged into this wispy section. Eevee as a render engine can handle tons and tons of lamps without falling to its knees, and so it becomes a matter of deciding when to stop. It's tempting to actually keep going all day, but we only really need to aim for when it's colorful and full of life, but not too full, if that makes sense. Here I'm pushing it pretty close to what I think would be the desired amount of lamps. And actually, it's good to scrub the timeline to around the end of the animation or just to some other spot from time to time to get to see the scene from a different perspective. Actually, who knows, maybe you might actually discover that you want to work some more on a portion of the nebula that potentially until then was out of view or something along those lines. Then we can just make that part shine, as is the purpose of lighting after all. One thing to be careful with is, as we've mentioned, even though everyone loves vibrant colors, it's worth keeping level-headed when it comes to the color saturation. It's something that can definitely be overdone, and there's a risk of making everything so colorful that the individual splotches of color will lose their impact, if that makes sense. Like everyone shouting at the same time and expecting the end result to be somehow coherent. As I'm saying that though, I am throwing in some brighter pinks in there, so we recognize the irony. It does look cool though, and because that isn't something we can easily allow ourselves in cycles, it just makes sense to become slightly mischievous in our experimentation, I guess. That is as far as the colors go anyway. Alright, so I think it's got some cool interstellar flamboyancy going on here. We've got some really nice points of interest scattered amidst our nebulascape. Your take on it could look completely different, and that's okay. Just follow your own sensibilities. Oh, and share your result with us on social media, please. We love seeing that stuff. All right, great. So all in all, it took us around, it looks like 14 point lights of various power and color to paint across our nebula. The best part is it still works pretty fast. At least I can feel no significant performance hit here in this example. When it's time to make a final render, the settings can be revisited, of course, mainly to set the tile size back to its best looking option, which is 2 pixels, which will hurt the performance probably the most, which you can prove by trying to change just about anything, but mostly it doesn't matter, as we're just going to render this out as animation at this point and call it a day. Like we've mentioned in the previous example, the volumetric samples can have a maximum value of 256, and in many cases it offers a better quality, but that's not always the case, so it could be worth testing for your final render, as you might save yourself quite a bit of time. I'll leave these settings as is and choose a different folder for the output, so preview_02, and I think we can be proud of ourselves and give it a render. Before pushing the button though, I wanted to show something really briefly. The Eevee multitasking or multi-rendering capabilities will extend to volume shaders as well. For example, Eevee reacts really well to multiple gas cloud types working together. Here, for example, I duplicated the main volume, and what I want to do is give it a new material. Let me switch back to the faster tile size though for a moment, just to help demonstrate. So this is our second volumetric cube, which we can call volume underscore O2 underscore mist. And now we can just create a new shader and call it the same, volume underscore O2 underscore mist. And we'll use this to simulate a thin veil of gas or something along those lines. We don't really need anything going into its density, as it'll be just this uniform mist of sorts. So I'll delete these nodes and then add a value node to control both densities at the same time for these volume shaders. And now I'll just see how it looks with a moderate fogginess. There's apparently no extra cost for adding this effect from what I can tell. It still runs fast in the viewport, so we can preview our animation once more. One thing that could be worth fixing is that with the mist thrown into the mix, the point light's placement became very evident. It almost breaks the illusion of the self-illuminated gas. So something that could be useful is the light clamping. As soon as we nudge this slider, we'll see how these bright spots have got totally muffled. Maybe a bit too much, actually. Maybe something like 100 could work well, or perhaps even higher. Let's try 500, or maybe 1000, actually. Yeah, with 1000, that looks like it should do the trick, I think. Before moving on, let's just roll the mist density back a little bit. Or you may want to get rid of it completely and nobody would ask why, to be fair. In this example, though, I think something like 0.2 looks good to me anyway. Though, actually, all right, so tweaking sliders in small increments is a running joke between artist types, as they say. But actually, I think 0.15 is slightly better in this case. And if anyone asks, we can just say we're doing our part keeping the small increments joke alive. All right, I think now we should be good to go. So back to 2 pixels tile size with the rest of the settings given some consideration. The volume samples specifically and the shadow samples as well. It's something that could be worth giving a boost for the final render. But I'll just go ahead and fire it up and render the animation. All right, so that wraps it up. And here you can see the final result, where each frame took about 30 seconds, so about an hour for the entire animation, which is pretty amazing given the lighting complexity and how much it would take to produce something like that in cycles. So thanks for watching. I'm AD Burrows, and this concludes the multi-light, multi-volume Eevee tutorial from the Nebula course update. As a quick reminder, you can enroll in the course and get more than 8 hours of training and all the project files over on Blender Market and Gumroad. And in the next video, we'll be making this nice little traversing the shadow realm animation in Eevee. So keep watching.